some of it actually drawing from basic ecological science, thinking about monitoring. So I'm going to do four things. I haven't got very long, so this is going to be a bit of a walk through. So first of all, I'll just start by defining what we mean by natural capital and wealth. And there I'm really giving you the natural capital view on what natural capital is. Then just taking this comprehensive view of natural capital, I think it's really important for the monitoring framework that we start by taking all perspectives. Then I'll go into a little bit of a discussion about how we measure the value of it, and then some general comments about monitoring. So firstly, what is natural capital? Well, very generally, it's the parts of the natural environment that produce value to people. And I usually show this little diagram, which for me symbolizes the idea that there's a lot of natural capital underpinning human well-being, and that in this diagram, everything depends on natural capital. That is, the economy depends on natural capital in very many ways. And this diagram also shows you these three or four major types of capital that are often recognized. Natural capital, stuff that the environment provides for free that underpins our economies. Social and human capital, such as what all the people in this room doing and working together to provide, and then produce and manufacture capital, the blue bit, which is the bit that we usually report on that goes into national statistics and GDP and so on. So natural capital is potentially very important. And that set of assets is actually what should be regarded as wealth. Now the other thing the natural capital community does is recognize that natural capital is more than ecosystems and it's more than biodiversity. Sometimes these things get equated, but natural capital includes the non-renewable subsoil assets, which don't formally come into the definitions of ecosystems. But having said that, it's not everything. Natural capital is not everything in the environment because of this economic focus. It's bounded by economics and some emphasis on utility, i.e. it's parts of the environment that underpin the things that are useful for people, underpin the world in the world. And when I say that, I don't mean narrow utility. I don't mean that we use it today and it has a market and a value. I mean broad, inclusive, far-sighted utility. If we get rid of this, we may not be able to recover it, and it may be very part of human well-being. So this utility word you've got to use very carefully. It's very broad and it's inclusive. And then finally, moving on from ecosystem services to have a bit of a bigger emphasis on stocks rather than flows. So wealth is that stock of assets that generate future income and well-being. So we can have a wealth of natural capital, which is the stock of natural capital assets that underpin that future world. The flow of value, the thing that we measure in ecosystem services, is the return on wealth. So it's a slightly different thing. And wealth and income are related, but not necessarily the same thing. So measuring ecosystem services does not necessarily equate to measuring wealth of natural capital. And just to think about that in an easier term, you know, somebody, this is Blenheim Palace, I think, that's a huge asset. But actually, I think they have trouble balancing their books on an annual basis. Whereas these footballers or basketball players have almost no asset, but they have massive annual flow income. So that's sort of just a symbolic difference between income and wealth, as I'm going to use natural capital wealth. This is some figures put together by Kirk Hamilton and Cameron Hepburn, trying to summarise how those bits of capital are distributed between the produced human, natural, and intangible kinds of assets. It's really interesting, actually. So the total block is just estimated as the present value of future consumption. do is use bottom-up measures to allocate that total wealth into produced human and natural. Actually, they do it for produced and natural, and then they look at the residuals to get the human, and then there's this intangible residual. So, there's clearly something wrong with this, because sometimes the sum of the parts is greater than the total, which is possibly true. But there are two interesting things about it. One is how important human capital is here, which we don't really account for very much. But secondly, natural capital is vanishing in these more assessments. There's the UK, and there's our natural capital. And I think that's because, for very many reasons, it's seriously underestimated using these kinds of methods. So why is it underestimated? Well, for a whole set of reasons. One is that many of those values come from prices, which are subject to all kinds of biases, not just biases in preference, but biases in utility. That over time, some things are important or have high value, and some aren't. Just think about the way in which forests have changed in value over centuries of human use. So that, and if you just try to use the price of some commodity, you're seriously undervalued. Sometimes there aren't markets, and these estimates can use other kinds of valuation techniques to come up with shadow prices, but I think they still tend to underestimate. There are a whole set of values that are simply missing either within natural asset classes. So for example, for woodlands, you will tend to get a value for timber, but you certainly won't get anything for wildlife conservation. You probably don't get anything for water regulation. You may be able to put something in for carbon sequestration, but that's not always fine, and so on. And then the accounts are very incomplete. They don't, for example, include soil at the moment, which is probably one of our most important natural assets. So one of the things that we need to do is to take a more comprehensive approach, a more inclusive approach, rather than this bottom-up counting of things that have demonstrable. And this is the kind of framework that the Natural Capital Committee has used, a set of natural capital assets, and you manage those in various ways to provide flows of services and goods, and then with other capital inputs you can produce them in capital, those produce things of value to people. So then you have a rather hard question, and this is a particularly important one for monitoring, about what are the assets and what are the benefits. And this can get ridiculously complicated if you start trying to allocate into these classes. So here's a set of kinds of assets that we've come up with: species, critical communities, soil, freshwater, land, minerals, the atmosphere, subsoil assets, as well as all the natural processes and functions. And those between them ultimately deliver that set of benefits on like food, fiber, energy, clean water, clean air, recreation, aesthetics. Now, if you think about the things on the right, any one of those requires many of these things on the left. Food, for example, requires a few species, ecological communities, soil, fresh water, land, minerals, microbes, atmospheres, subsoil assets, and so on. So if you try to work through this, allocating assets to underpinning assets to benefits, you end up with something that's horrendously complex. Big data and big data analysts very happy and occupied for 20 years or so, but would end up not telling us anything very useful at all. So the other way around is to think about those things on the right, the benefits, and the changes in potential value of those, and the major natural capital asset that underpins each. And then you end up with a bit more manageable. That's what I mean by this comprehensive, but still a utility-based view of natural capital. So we're going to define the value of a natural capital asset in terms of the value of the benefits that society derives from. And that's not just now, that's a prospective view of whether we might at some point need more of it and how difficult it is. And the important thing, the reason I'm saying all this, is that those this way of thinking about it will give you measures that are different to measures of the asset itself. So for example, let's just think about the value of restoration of blanket bulk for clean and clear water. So on this axis, we're just moving from a highly disturbed blanket bulk, one that's been completely drained and actually not drawn anymore, to a pristine blanket bulk on the right hand side. But if you measure that in terms of its value, its utility for clean water, which is the thing that's probably most useful for, that has this very nonlinear relationship. At low levels, it doesn't go on being useful until you get to a certain quality, and then there's a very rapid threshold where suddenly it becomes useful for doing what it is, and then it plateaus off again. And so if you just measure what's on the x-axis, which would be the state of the natural asset, you wouldn't get this utility properly represented. And the shape of these relationships, I think, is quite important to understand, to think about measuring the value of the natural assets. The shape of the curve for both recreation and wildlife, from increasing the extent of woodlands in the UK, is a kind of saturating curve. At the beginning, they both benefit, but then it levels off and plateaus as you get to a certain area. But really importantly, for wildlife, it isn't the area that matters, it's the management type of the woodland, and for recreation, it's the location of the woodland. So you have to think very carefully about what's on that x-axis. Just measuring the extent will only give you part of the story. So that's about measuring natural capital. I just want to sort of make a few points about monitoring, which is slightly different to measuring. So monitoring is about gathering information on these state variables over time to draw some inference about changing state. So monitoring is about gathering these measures over time for some purpose. And that purpose is important to think about, because the way that you do the monitoring depends what the purpose is. And it also determines how you should allocate funding for monitoring. It depends what you're trying to do with this data. It could be that you're just doing it to gather more information, or it could be you're doing it to guide some decision. And I think it's worth thinking about this spectrum that goes from monitoring that's really just knowledge focused at the outset. I just want to know more about how the world works. Charles Fielding measuring CO2 concentrations in the atmosphere on a monthly basis, just because I'm interested in what we're doing in the atmosphere. That would be right at the top of this spectrum. And it's a kind of monitoring that's just to see what's going on in the world, because we may discover something. And you can move through this spectrum, still a knowledge-based one, but actually you're just trying to look for some perturbation, something happening that isn't really expected, through raising awareness, auditing management actions. We said we would increase the amount of woodland that's measuring. And then the one at the bottom about really informing policy and decisions. We want to know how to allocate resources to a series of different projects, which one should be allocated. I've drawn this from a paper in Conservation Biology, actually, which has some really useful thoughts about this. Now, I think in the natural capital arena, we're close to the bottom of this. This monitoring is action-focused. It's intended to guide decisions and investment. And that's because if you look at the NCC's 25-year plan to restore natural capital, we don't want to simply monitor natural capital as it continues down this red trajectory. Here's some measure of the state of natural capital. We know it's declining. We're at 2015. We don't want to simply monitor what's going on down there. Actually, the goal set out in the government white paper is to restore natural capital within a generation. That means it's got to actually follow up on that green line. It's a major commitment, not just to halt the rate of decline or improve its slightly, but to completely reverse it, to bring it back up so that in 25 means we're going to have to look at projects that will restore natural capital, bring it up there. I think that means this monitoring is very much more in terms of decision support. And what we have to do is allocate funding for monitoring in a way that most is most likely to help you achieve this objective of restoring natural capital. That is, you monitor in a way that helps you define high-value projects for recovery and restoration. So it's not just about measuring it. Okay, I'll finish there. Just to summarise, so we've defined natural capital assets and provided a basis for metrics around this idea of a very broad inclusive utility. So the metrics of natural capital assets should relate to the benefits that emerge from them, not just what is easiest or most commonly measured for any type of natural capital. And then the monitoring should be designed to gather information from the metrics efficiently, so with relevance to the objective, which in our case can't be applied. I mean, having said that, I've skimmed over a whole lot of really poorly understood areas, and there is a whole stack of work to be done to make any of this possible. In particular, to streamline and validate those metrics, but also there's quite a lot to be done to do